In this video, I will be discussing one of the popular polar curves, which is the rose curve. So here, we will sketch the graph of the following polar curves in the XY plane. So number one, we have R is equal to 2 sine 3 theta. So what is the graph of this polar curve? First, we must recall the graph of the basic function involved in this polar equation, which is the sine function. So in this very basic trigonometric function, which is the sine function, we learn from our trigonometry class that the graph of this is a sinusoidal curve. So in this R theta plane, wherein the horizontal axis is our theta and the vertical axis is our R, we can sketch the graph of this basic function in this R theta plane. And we know that the period of this one is 2 pi. So this is our 2 pi. So halfway to 2 pi is our pi. And then halfway to pi, we know that is pi over 2. And also, halfway from pi to 2 pi is our 3 halves pi here. And we know that in this basic function, sine theta, that its amplitude is 1. So it has a maximum height of the graph of 1 and a minimum height of negative 1. So the graph is between negative 1 to 1. So if you sketch the graph of this, we know from our trigonometry class that when theta is 0, it's 0. But when your theta is pi over 2, it's 1. And if it is pi, it is also 0. And when it is 3 halves pi, it is negative 1. And then we know that at 2 pi, the sine is 0 again. So connecting these points, we sketch the graph of this sinusoidal curve, this one here. So that's the graph of the basic function sine theta. And we know from this basic function that our amplitude here is 1. And our period is 2 pi. Therefore, our subinterval here is 2 pi divided by 4, which is pi over 2. If you reduce 2 pi over 4, that is pi over 2. But our equation that we need to graph is having an amplitude of 2. And we notice that there is a numerical coefficient to theta, which is 3. And this numerical coefficient of 3 is shrinking the graph in the horizontal axis. So our amplitude here is 2 because of this 2 here. And the period is not anymore 2 pi because the role of 3 here shrunk the graph within the horizontal axis. So to compute for the period, we have 2 pi divided by our n. And our n here is 3. So therefore, our subinterval is a quarter of our period. And if you divide this 2 pi over 3 by 4, we have pi over 6. Because this becomes 2 pi over 3. When you divide it by 4, that becomes 2 pi over 12. And 2 pi over 12, when you reduce, that is pi over 6. So, in the R theta plane, R, which is equal to 2 sine 3 theta, can be plotted here because we know the period, which is 2 pi over 3. So here, suppose this is our 2 pi over 3. So halfway to 2 pi over 3 is pi over 3. And halfway from 0 to pi over 3 is pi over 6. And halfway from pi over 3 to 2 pi over 3 is pi over 2. So if you plot this polar equation in this r theta plane, our amplitude is 2 here. But our period is 2 pi over 3. So it starts here. When theta is 0, it's 0. And it goes up to 2, which is the amplitude when it is pi over 6. And then back to 0 when theta is pi over 3. And when it is pi over 2, it is negative 2. Then goes back to 0 when theta is 2 pi over 3. Now, if you connect this one, we have a sinusoidal curve like this one. And suppose we want to reach until 2 pi, so we will repeat this period 3 times because of this numerical coefficient of 3. So in the range of 2 pi in our theta, we will have 3 periods in our graph because of this 3. So if we add pi over 6 to 2 pi over 3, we have 5 pi over 6. And adding pi over 6 to this 5 pi over 6, it's the whole pi. And then pi plus pi over 6 is 7 pi over 6. And then plus pi over 6, that is 4 pi over 3. And then plus pi over 6 again, we have 3 halves pi. And again, adding pi over 6 to this 3 pi over 2, we have 5 pi over 3. And 5 pi over 3 plus pi over 6 is 11 pi over 6. And adding one more, this becomes 2 pi. And why is it that we are adding pi over 6? Because our subinterval is pi over 6. Now, the sum interval that I am talking about is the quarter of the whole period. So, from 2 pi over 3 to 5 pi over 6, the graph is at its maximum of 2. And after another subinterval, it goes back to 0. And another subinterval, it goes down to negative 2. And then another subinterval, back again to 0. So if you connect this one here, you will have another period of our graph. And because we still have one more period, we need to add another one cycle of the graph. So another pi over 6, the graph reaches its maximum height, which is the amplitude. And then for another subinterval, it goes back to 0. One more subinterval goes to the minimum, which is negative 2, and then back again to 0. So connecting these points, we have another period of our graph. So as you can see, that there are 3 periods here of our graph, because the graph is being shrunk within the horizontal axis of theta, and that is due to the numerical coefficient of theta, which is 3. So you see here one period, the black curve, and then another period, which is the blue curve, and then last period, which is the red curve. So using this graph in the r theta plane, we will graph our polar equation in the xy plane. So in the xy plane, so this is our x and this is our y. So our horizontal axis is not anymore the theta, because theta is the angle it makes from the horizontal axis when this terminal line is moving counterclockwise. So you see that at theta 0, it's 0. So it's here. Because in our graph, we have 2 concentric circles here, and the first circle is having a radius of 1, and the second circle is having a radius of 2. So at pi over 6, it's 2. But from 0 to pi over 6, it increases smoothly. So I will have a curve that is slowly increasing here and then goes to 2. And then when theta is pi over 3, it goes back to 0. So here is our pi over 3, because this is our pi over 6. So when it reaches pi over 3, it slowly goes back to 0. And then from pi over 3 to pi over 2, it goes down to negative 2. So here from pi over 3 to pi over 2, it goes down to negative 2. So instead of having 2 here, it's in the opposite direction here. So it is moving here like this. And then from pi over 2 to 2/3 pi, which is this one, this is our 2/3 pi, it goes back to 0. So here, when your angle reaches to 2/3 pi, it goes back to 0 here. And then to 5 pi over 6, which is this one, it goes back to 2. So increases to 2 here when it reaches to 5 pi over 6. And then slowly going down to 0 when it reaches pi. So this is our pi. It slowly goes back to 0 when it reaches the pi. So you notice that we start from 0 when the theta is 0, and then when it reaches to pi over 6, it goes to the highest point, which is 2. So it's here. And then from the highest point, it continues to go down to 0 when it reaches the angle of pi over 3. So at pi over 3, it goes down here. And from pi over 3 to pi over 2, it continues to go down to negative 2. So from this angle up to this angle, instead that the radius is 2, it should be in the opposite direction. So it goes down. So it's in the opposite direction here. And then when theta is moving from pi over 2 to 2/3 pi, the value of r is increasing. So when our angle is moving from pi over 2 to 2/3 pi, our radius is increasing from negative 2 to 0 here. And then from 2/3 pi to 5 pi over 6, we have our value of the r that is at the maximum point of 2. So moving to the maximum point of 2 when the angle is 5 pi over 6. And then from 5 pi over 6 to pi, it goes down again to 0 when the angle is moving to pi. And then from pi to 7 pi over 6, which is this one, the value is having a negative 2. So it moves here. Instead of having a 2 here, it is in the opposite direction. So tracing the same path there. So this one is the graph of our polar equation, r equals 2 sine 3 theta. So this is a rose curve of 3 petals. So moving to our second example, which is r equals 3 cosine 2 theta, we can first sketch the graph of the basic function, which is the cosine theta, in the r theta plane. And we know from our trigonometry class that the graph of this is a sinusoidal curve with an amplitude of 1 and a period of 2 pi. So suppose this is our 2 pi. So halfway to 2 pi is pi, and halfway to pi is pi over 2. And also from pi to 2 pi in between is 3 halves pi here. So if this is our 1 here, and this is also our negative 1, the graph is within this negative 1 and 1. And we know that when this theta is 0, our r is 1. So it's here. And then cosine of pi over 2, it's 0. And cosine of pi, it's negative 1. And then cosine of 3 halves pi is 0 again. And cosine of 2 pi is back at 1. So if you connect these points, we form a sinusoidal curve like this. So this is the graph of the basic trigonometric function cosine theta when plotted in the r theta plane. So remember that this is our r, the vertical axis, and this is our theta, the horizontal axis. But this is not our goal. Our goal is to graph this r equals 3 cosine 2 theta. And because we have a 3 here, we are informed that our amplitude is 3. So 1, 2, 3. So this is the maximum height of the graph. And then 1, 2, and 3. This is the minimum height of the graph. And since we have a 2 here as a numerical coefficient of theta, our graph is being shrunk within this horizontal axis. Since we know from this basic function that our amplitude here is 1 and our period here is 2 pi, then our amplitude of this polar equation is not anymore 1 but 3. And our period is not anymore 2 pi but it's half of this, because the whole period will be divided by the coefficient of theta, which is 2. So 2 pi divided by 2, the whole period is pi. So our subinterval is pi over 4. So if this is our pi, this will be divided into 4, because our subinterval is pi over 4. So pi over 4 here plus another pi over 4, which is pi over 2. And then when you add pi over 4, that is 3 pi over 4 there. So when your theta is 0, your graph is at the maximum height, which is 3. And then after one subinterval, it goes down to 0. And then another subinterval, it goes down to the minimum, which is negative 3. Another subinterval goes back to 0 and increases to 3 at pi. So if you connect these points, you form a sinusoidal curve, which is like this. And then if you add another period, so pi plus one subinterval, that is 5 pi over 4. And then another pi over 4, that is 3 halves pi. And another pi over 4, we have 7 pi over 4. Plus another subinterval, that becomes 2 pi. So from this point, if you add one more subinterval, the curve goes down to 0 here. And then moving to one subinterval, the graph continues to go down to the minimum point, which is negative 3. And adding another subinterval, it increases to 0. And for one more subinterval, it continues to increase to its maximum height, which is positive 3. So this is the graph of this r equals 3 cosine 2 theta in the r theta plane. So we will write here in the r theta plane our polar equation, which is 3 cosine 2 theta is having a graph of this one. And comparing this graph from the graph of the basic function cosine theta, the graph is being shrunk within this horizontal axis theta. Now using this one to plot our polar equation in the xy plane, we will have to start at 0. So at 0, so when your theta is 0, the value of the r is 3. So it's here. So when your angle is 0, the radius is 3. But as you move to pi over 4, the radius decreases until it will reach 0. So this is our pi over 4. So when your angle is moving to pi over 4, the radius decreases to 0. So it moves here to 0. And then from pi over 4, the value of the radius continues to decrease from 0 to negative 3. So here from pi over 4, if you move a little movement, our radius is decreasing to negative numbers. So it goes down here. And then when you reach pi over 2, which is this angle, it reaches to the minimum point of negative 3. So it's here. And then from pi over 2 to 3/4 pi, because this is our pi over 2 and this is our 3/4 pi, our radius starts to increase from negative 3 to 0. So when it reaches here, because the radius is negative, so it should be in the negative, in the opposite direction. So our radius continues to increase from negative 3 to 0 here. And then as you move your theta from 3 pi over 4 to pi, the value of the radius continues to increase from 0 to 3. So here, from 0 to 3, from 3/4 pi to pi. So here, it continues to increase to 3 here. And then from pi to 5 pi over 4, it starts to decrease from 3 to 0. So here is our pi. And then moving to 5 pi over 4, the radius decreases from 3 going to 0. And it will be 0 at 5 pi over 4. So here. And then moving from 5 pi over 4 to 3/2 pi, the r decreases from 0 to negative 3. So here, if your angle is 5 pi over 4 to 3/2 pi, because this is our 3/2 pi, the graph is from 0, so it's here. But moving from this angle to this angle, the radius starts to decrease to negative. So instead of having a radius here, it's in the opposite direction here. And then it reaches the minimum of negative 3, because at 3/2 pi, instead of having 3, it's in the opposite direction. So it should be here. So it reaches negative 3. And then from 3/2 pi to 7 pi over 4, from here up to here, the value of the radius starts to increase from negative 3 to 0. So here, because this is our 7 pi over 4. And then from 7 pi over 4, which is at 0, it increases to the maximum of 3. So here, from 0, increases to the maximum of 3, which goes back to our original starting point here. So to summarize, from 0 to pi over 4, it's from 3 to 0. So it's this one. And then from pi over 4 to pi over 2, it decreases from 0 to negative 3. So here. So at pi over 2, instead of having here, it's in the opposite direction, negative 3. And then from pi over 2 to 3/4 pi, here, it goes back to 0. And then from 3/4 pi to pi, it continues to increase to 3. So it's here. And then from pi to 5/4 pi, it decreases to 0. And then from 5/4 pi to 3/2 pi, it decreases to negative. So it's in the opposite direction. Instead of having here 3, it's in the opposite direction. So it's here. And then from 3/2 pi to 7/4 pi, it increases from negative 3 to 0. So here. And then from 7/4 pi to 2 pi, it increases from 0 to 3. So it's here. So back to the original starting point. So what do you observe? The graph is a rose with 4 petals. With these illustrative examples, we notice that the first number here represents the length of the petals. So generally, we can represent our equation as A sine N theta. So in this case, our A is 2. And as you can see, that the length of the petal is 2. So with this one, we say that A is the radius of the rose curve. And this 3 represents the number of petals. But this is very confusing because in our second example, if that is 2, we have 4 petals. Now you can investigate this one, and I hope you can see the connection of this n value to the number of petals. And after your investigation, you can see that when your n is an odd number, then the number of petals is just equal to that number. And when your n is an even number, then the number of petals is twice to that number. So that's why when our n is 2, the number of petals is 4. Because 2 is an even number, so when it is even, the number of petals is twice to that number. So that's why we have 4 petals here. And it is very interesting to note, where is the first petal starting? When the function is sine, the first petal starts at the first subinterval, which is pi over 2 divided by n. So pi over 2n. So here, our n is 3. So 2 times 3 is 6. So that's why pi over 6 is the first petal here. Now how about for the cosine rose curve? In the cosine, r equals a cosine n theta, a is still the length of the petal, which is the radius of the rose curve. And just the same, that when your n is an odd number, then the number of petals is n. But when your n is an even number, then the number of petals is twice of that even number. And it is very interesting to note that the first petal starts at always the polar axis. when the rose curve is defined in terms of the cosine function. So those are the generalization of these rose curves. So at this point, it is good to summarize our generalizations we have constructed in the previous board. So when our rose curve is defined in terms of sine function, we have R which is equal to A sine N theta, then therefore, the length of the petal is A. So here, A. And N determines the number of petals. So when N is odd, then the number of petals is equal to that number, which is an odd number. But when your N is even, then the number of petals is twice of that even number. So 2N. And the first petal should start at the angle pi over 2N. That is when our rose curve is in terms of the sine function. Because when our rose curve is defined in terms of cosine function, the starting point of our first petal is not at pi over 2n, but always at the polar axis. And of course, the length of the petal is A. And the number of petals is determined by the value of n. So again, when n is odd, then the number of petals is equal to that odd number, which is n. And when n is even, the number of petals is equal to twice of that even number. So we have here 2n. Thus, with these generalizations, it is very convenient for us to sketch the graph of our rose curve in the xy plane. So here, sketch the graph of the following polar curves in the xy plane. So in this equation, R equals 4 cosine 5 theta, we are informed that the length of our petal is 4 because our value of A is 4. And the number of petals is 5 because our N is 5. So this implies that the number of petals is 5. And because this is in terms of the cosine function, we are here in this generalization, the first petal should start at the polar axis. So here, first petal at the polar axis. And since there are 5 petals here, we will divide the whole revolution into 5 to equally place all the 5 petals in one revolution. So our one revolution is 360. We divide it by 5, and this is equal to 72 degrees. So the first petal should start here, 0 degree, and then we add 72 degrees, so it should be here. This is 72 degrees, and adding another 72 degrees, that is 144 degrees. So it's here, 144 degrees. And adding 72 degrees again, we have 216 degrees. And adding one more, that is 288 degrees. So our petals are equally spaced in the whole plane, which starts from here at the polar axis, and then now the second petal at 72 degrees, and then the next petal is at 144 degrees, and then the fourth petal is at 216 degrees, and the last petal at 288 degrees. So they are equally spaced in one complete revolution from 0 to 360, or 2 pi radians in radian measure. But the length of the petal is 4, so we'll count here 1, 2, 3, 4. So this is the length of the petal. And because the first petal is at the polar axis, we will draw the first petal. And then the second petal is located at 72 degrees. So here is our second petal. And then the third petal at 144 degrees. So this is now our third petal. And then the fourth petal at 216 degrees. And the fifth petal, the last petal at 288 degrees. So this is now the graph of this polar equation, which is a rose curve with five petals, where the length of each petal is 4. So this is easily facilitated because of our generalization. And you can check this graph using a graphing calculator, that this is really the graph of this polar equation that describes a rose curve. Next is to sketch the graph of this second polar equation, which is R equals 3 sine 4 theta. Now, with this polar equation, we know that the length of the petal is 3 because our A value is 3. And then our N value there is 4 here. And because this is an even number, we know that the number of petals is twice of this number, which is 8. And we also know that the first petal does not start at the polar axis because our polar equation is in terms of the sine function. So we are on this generalization here. So when the polar equation is in terms of the sine function, the first petal will be located at pi over 2n. So our first petal will be located at pi over 2 times 4. And 2 times 4 is 8. And in degrees, pi over 8 is 22.5 degrees. And since the first petal starts at 22.5 degrees, we should know the distance of every petal in our graph. So we will divide the whole revolution of 360 by the number of petals. And the number of petals is 8. So 360 divided by 8. And this is equal to 45 degrees. So this is the location of the first petal at 22.5 degrees. We will add 45 degrees, and that is at this angle here, which is 67.5 degrees. Adding another 45 degrees, that is 112.5 degrees. And adding 45 degrees again, we have this angle here, which is 157.5 degrees. And another 45 degrees, it's here, which is 202.5 degrees. Adding 45 here, moving to the next petal, is 247.5 degrees. And moving to the second to the last petal, we have 292.5 degrees by adding 45 degrees to 247.5 degrees. And then adding one more to get the last petal is this one, 337.5 degrees. And because the length of the petal is 3, we will have 1, 2, 3. So this is the length of the petal. So we can draw our first petal here. And then the second petal is at 67.5 degrees. We have here the second petal. And then the third petal here, the fourth petal, the fifth petal, the sixth petal, the seventh petal, and the eighth petal. So this is now a rose curve of eight petals. So this is the graph of this polar equation, which defines a rose curve of eight petals. And you can check using your graphing calculator that it starts from zero radius and then moving to a radius of three here, and then decreasing to a radius of zero, and then from zero it continues to decrease from zero to negative three here, and then from negative three it starts to increase from negative three to zero, and then from zero it continues to increase from zero to positive three here, and then from positive three back to zero, and then from zero it continues to decrease to negative three, and then from negative three back to zero, and then from zero to positive three, and then from positive three it decreases to zero, and then continues to decrease to negative three, because we are now in the angle of 247.5 degrees. And then from 247.5 degrees going to 292.5 degrees, it goes back to zero. And then from zero, it increases to positive three. And then from positive three, it decreases to zero. And then from zero continues to decrease to negative three, because you are moving to this angle, but it should be in the opposite direction. That's why it's negative three. And then from negative three, it starts to increase back to zero. And then from zero goes back again here. So it goes back to the starting point at the center. So that's the graph of a rose curve with eight petals. Also, you can trace the starting point of this rose curve, that at the angle of zero, it starts with the length of the petal, which is four. So from four, it decreases to zero. And then from zero, it continues to decrease to negative four. And then from negative four, it starts to increase to zero. And then from zero, continues to increase to positive four. And then from four, it decreases back to zero. And then from zero to negative four. And then from negative four, it increases to zero. And then from zero continues to increase to positive four. And then from positive four, it decreases back to zero. And then from zero, it decreases back to negative 4, which is the starting point here. So this is a graph of a rose curve with 5 petals defined by this polar equation, R equals 4 cosine 5 theta. If you learned something today, please check out my channel for more videos like this and click subscribe. Click the notification bell below so you'll get notified whenever I'll be posting a new video. Don't forget to like this video to show your support. And always remember to map your way up. Thank you.